Welcome or welcome back to Merill Talks. Today we've got a very technical video, actually diving into the ecosystem behind the accelerated computing that we're looking at currently, a very interesting space. And we're going to get straight into it. So strap in and let's go.
All right, so we're going to talk about AI. But you know, AI started in the cloud. It started in the cloud for a good reason, because it turns out that AI needs infrastructure. Well, now that we're going to take AI out to the rest of the world, the rest of the world has different system configurations, usage differences. And so AI, as it translates to enterprise IT, to manufacturing, as it translates to robotics or self-driving cars, or even companies that are starting GPU clouds. They like our leading edge technology. They like the fact that we have full stack. It's the chip, the programming model, and a whole bunch of software that goes on top of it. That entire stack is incredibly complex.
So, Mark, welcome.
Thank you, Mike. Welcome. Welcome to the audience.
And immediately, Mark, I'd love to understand the actual supply chain. When we talk about accelerated computing, what are we looking
at? Yes, before that, let's discuss here, because NVIDIA is the rising star. I know, Mike, you as a value investor, this is a name you don't like. That's for sure, especially on the valuation side. But here for the audience and for you, we are not here to speak about valuation here. We are talking about the supply chain. And as we know, NVIDIA, who was an obscure GPU makers, I know some people will be shocked, but before the LLM model, it was used only for game. I mean, maybe you used to be a fan of 3D games using GPU. But before that, before the LLM model, I mean, only the gamers, hardcore gamers like you, used to know NVIDIA. And now NVIDIA, it's at the beginning of these revolutions. It's feeding these revolutions. It's a chip maker. We will discuss here on this video about the challenger here. And I think it's very important, and for our audience now to see on the screen, and he has to stay maybe a few seconds on the screen, this is the supply chain. The supply chain is very important. Why? Years ago, if you have been following us, we did the same approach and same methodology for the semiconductors. And if for the nostalgic people, we will put here on the screen the old video we had about NVIDIA back 3 or 4 years ago, because the approach was understanding the supply chains of the chip makers here. But now we will start our journey with the chip maker at the beginning of the supply chain. So let me come back on the screen here. As you see, the chip maker are on the position one, following by the hyperscalers. So hyperscalers, just for the audience, as we know, it's Azure, Microsoft, AWS with Amazon, Google Cloud, Alibaba Cloud. So this is the hyperscalers. Now on the position three, system integrators and consulting firms. Of course, you know quite well all these companies. It could be Deloitte, KPMG, obviously, but more like one Accenture specialized on the IT side, or who are clearly, I will say, against the middleman. And on the positions, the fourth positions are the software companies who try to sell software to the end user. So clearly here, I think for our audience, it's very important to understand this, because we have the same methodology like with the semiconductor to understand how's the thing going on and how's the ecosystem working. With this revolution of generative AI, it's important to really have the supply chains, because even as an investor, you need to understand, because some on this supply chain will be challenged, definitely. And this is what we will discuss here.
And following up on this, Mark, I'm aware and would like you to elaborate on the margins and how they travel through the actual supply chain.
As you know, it's a good point, Mike. When you are at the beginning of the supply chain, you are nearly a monopole approach. and the margins are quite high. As we know, for sure, NVIDIA, but also Taiwan semiconductors who are designing. And for us as European, because we don't have some core jewel, I will say, I will speak about ASML, even everyone speak about ASML for years now, but because in Europe, unfortunately, we don't have so many companies we can speak about. I'm sorry about this for us fellow Europeans, but this is the reality. So the margin, obviously, of the chip maker are incredible. Now the hyperscaler, also the margin are attractive because nowadays we are moving in the cloud. I mean, all our systems are in the cloud. I'm old enough to remember before everything was on site. Now everything is in the cloud. Now, hopefully there is no problems because we know, for example, again, European, they don't have the most advanced things compared to the Americans because we're talking about Google, we're talking about Amazon, AWS, talking about Azure with Microsoft. We don't see like a very big cloud provider or hyperscalers in Europe here. So the margins are quite good on that side. Now we have also the consulting firms because don't forget, everything is plug-in, okay? So the hyperscalers, they need the GPU to work on it, that's for sure. And that's why we will discuss later on, did the hyperscaler need NVIDIA or they don't need it? That's the things. But for sure, the chip maker will challenge also the consulting firms.
So Mark, in terms of the actual categories that we've seen in terms of the supply chain, who's at risk?
As you can see, it's highlighting on the screen now, of course, it's the consulting firms. Accenture has issuing a very bad result. A company like Capgemini also, but I will say all the consulting firms. Why? Because in the past, they have been the intermediary between the hyperscalers and even not on the B2B side, even not the end user, but they have been like, okay, we will help you to plug. But nowadays, the hyperscalers, they can even challenge everyone on the consulting firms. Even us, I will say, as a financial company, we can imagine one day Microsoft coming and say, okay, we'll offer you a financial service. We are not yet there, but what they do, the hyperscaler, they are challenging clearly the consulting firms like Capgemini, Accenture, but also Deloitte in the way, because nowadays with the generative AI, the LM model, we can plug in the things. We know, for example, coding becoming easy, no? We can put some prompt and we do the things and we have the instructions. So we don't need to use C, C++ or Java, etc. No, we just need to prompt the things, and even we can imagine in the near future, we can just speak to the machine and the machine will execute, that for sure. So clearly the hyperscalers, they are on the second positions, but they are also challenging the chip makers. Why? Because you need to have GPU. So they're coming, it's like a rant. They're coming like AWS, say, okay, I need this kind of power, I need this number of GPU. And now they can say, oh, why I'm not developing my own chip? So Amazon, Google, obviously what they do, they are trying to develop also their own chip. Why we need NVIDIA here? We can have our own chip, we are happy with it. So the hyperscaler are challenging at the beginning of the supply chain and just after them, which is system integrators and consulting firms.
Mark, can we get a bit more into detail with actual names in terms of hyperscalers?
Yes, for sure. Let's start with the most famous one, which is Microsoft. So clearly Microsoft is building AI accelerators like MIA to control AI stack end-to-end, reducing reliance on third-party chip makers. And we know Microsoft, us, we consider as a conglomerate to be present not only used to be an operating system provider, but now is really into the cloud and one of the top cloud provider and hyperscaler. And of course, he will challenge. And even us, because on a day-to-day, we are using Office and we see what they offer, what kind of, how they extend the things, how they help us to integrate, for example, a software loop to cooperative software, SharePoint, etc., etc. So clearly here they are challenging, and of course, why they should be reliant on the chip makers and why NVIDIA? That's the things when they can develop their own things. That's for sure. So the next one, obviously, it's on the screen now, it's Amazon. I mean, it's a very well-known company, and clearly for them, because just if you put on the rank, probably Microsoft and Amazon or AWS, they are side by side. If you exclude probably Alibaba Cloud, who are also quite strong on that side. So for them, they have like replacing off-the-shelf CPU by their own, clearly, GPU. That's the thing. So these revolutions of AI and generative AI is the revolutions of moving from CPU to GPU. Clearly here, for our audience, I mean, CPU used to be really dedicated to do everything. Now we know that generative AI needs GPU. And I think Amazon is aware about this and developing. So clearly NVIDIA will see going forward in the next 1 or 2 years, clearly here, because the hyperscaler doesn't need any more NVIDIA if they are developing their own stuff. So clearly here Amazon introduced Graviton 4, and they will continue to develop on that side.
So Mark, we talked about the hyperscalers moving down the supply chain.
Mm-hmm.
How about NVIDIA moving up?
Now, of course, it's an interesting thing. I mean, we can ask the question and reverse the questions. Why the hyperscaler want to bypass the chip maker, but the chip maker could bypass also the hyperscaler. And I think NVIDIA is also developing its own software, helping also this, we don't need the hyperscalers, developing also a lot of things on the driving side, helping and this. So NVIDIA, as we know, the CEO is quite smart, is the new man. Is it the guys who will replace Elon Musk on the side of Trump? Could be. I mean, don't forget one thing. Additional fraud of the Trump administration was to block the chip to be sent to China, and it was reversed thanks for the effort of the CEO. Long time ago he was also speaking in Beijing, explaining in Chinese that he's here, so he's here to help the Chinese. So obviously, for me, he's not a newcomer, and he can replace Elon Musk. Probably yes, because he's not definitely the same style as Elon Musk. And I think Trump wants probably someone who's more like just techie and not making comment outside of that, which was the problem of Elon Musk. So clearly, come back on NVIDIA. This is such an incredible company, because I think they start with so many failures. When they developed the NV1 initially, was a problematic on the manufacturing side. And we know it because it was here at Esto in Microelectronic here in Malta. So they have multiple failures. So that, what I say, why the entrepreneur in US are so fantastic, because they fail multiple times and finally they make it. So obviously NVIDIA, seeing what's the threat from the hyperscaler, they will go and straight the things and say, okay, why we don't offer driving assistance, because as we know, a lot of people, we spoke about the robo taxis and stuff, why we don't offer directly to the people directly this kind of service, because they have a strong, because we always see NVIDIA as a hardware company, but it's also a software company. And that's why I say it's very important for our audience to understand that NVIDIA is not only a hardware company, but it's also a software company. Knowing it's a software company, it can challenge the hyperscaler, it can challenge the consulting firms, and going directly on B2B against the enterprise. I mean, they will not stay like this, NVIDIA, and that's for sure, and they will challenge. So that's why I think the competition is really tough, and this is for us as an end user, it's fantastic. We are facing something fantastic, because this battle will be beneficiary for everyone, that's for sure.
Let's talk about the Chinese, Mark, when it comes to the supply chain on their side.
Yes, I mean, of course it's interesting, because high competitions on the domestic side for NVIDIA, but the hyperscaler, but maybe the outsider. Again, Remember February, DeepSeek moment? The Chinese, they can provide same technology like ChatGPT at a very low cost and without using maybe so much GPU. So obviously Huawei, and we will see on the screen who are the challenger. And that's why I say there is a battle at the level of a domestic battle as we discussed previously, but the challenger are potentially coming from China. And we could face a DeepSeek moment. So as we can see at the beginning of the supply chain, we are Huawei. Again, we have to know that China spent a lot of money on the chip. It was a failure for many years, but they are now racing. It's like we can think about the electrical vehicles when no one was seeing Chinese coming 4 or 5 years ago, especially here in Europe. And we know that how the company are facing here, BMW, Mercedes, Stellantis are facing now the competition, heavy competitions of the AV from China. Against also Alibaba Cloud, a very strong hyperscaler, that's for sure. Competition is also intense in China with Alibaba, JD versus Pinduoduo and all these things. And again, we see, because what we want to see, and I'm showing again on the screen, at the bottoms, you have the ecosystem in US. So starting with NVIDIA, Amazon, Accenture, and Oracle on the B2B. At the top, you have China. So for us, the message here is like, of course, there is a battle domestic, as we say, but also as an investor, you should be also aware there is company who are coming, who are very well known. I know Huawei was banned in several countries in Europe, especially with this race of 5G. Now we are more in the direction of the 6G. But again, for our audience, and again a message, you can be very surprised where are the challenger, because they are the visible one. You can find Amazon versus Microsoft, Google, etc. And they're the one who are, could be like hidden and coming when you don't expect them. And I call this the DeepSeek moment. And really in 2025, we realized that these challenges can come from China.
So Mark, thank you very much for that. I hope everyone enjoyed the deep dive into the ecosystem. I think it's one that is very relevant at the moment. Exactly. I recommend that you check out our website, merrillfunds.com, and also our LinkedIn, Merrill Investors. And we hope to see you in the next video. Thank you for joining us, and we wish you the best. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Thank you, Mike. See you soon.